worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Friends, what are the four foundations of awareness? One, seeing the body as a full frame, while always acutely alert and clearly comprehending, thus removing any lust, urge, envy, frustration, and discontent rooted in this world. The intelligent Bhikkhu keeps contemplating and regarding any and all bodies as alien frames of filthy and foul form, as something bound to emerge, decay and vanish, neither as me, mine, nor belonging to me, nor as what I am, nor as a manifested representation of a myself, neither as lasting, stable, or safety, neither as pleasant beauty or pride. That is seeing the body as a full frame. Two, the second factor of the four foundations of awareness is regarding any feeling as an annoying reaction. The intelligent Bhikkhu keeps contemplating and regarding any and all feeling as a remote and ever-recurring reactivity, as something bound to arise, decay and fade away, not as mine, felt by me, nor belong to me, nor as what I am, nor as something felt by my very self, neither as lasting, stable, safe, neither as ever pleasure or lasting bliss. That is regarding any feeling as an annoying reaction. The third factor, the third foundation of awareness is noticing mind just as passing moods. The intelligent Bhikkhu keeps contemplating and regarding any and all mind as a habituated set of bizarre mentalities of a weird nature that appears, dwindles, flutters and flickers. He regards none of these moods as something that I am, nor as a part of a me, nor as making up of my ego or myself. He regards neither of these passing moods as lasting, stable, or ever same. He does not see them as fascinating, nor as a soul or a personality. The fourth foundation of awareness is knowing all phenomena only as momentary appearances, only as passing mental states, Dhamma. The intelligent Bhikkhu keeps contemplating and regarding any and all phenomena only as mentally constructed appearances of momentary manifestation, always ending right there, where they emerged. These appearances does not regard as mine, belong to me, or as self, or as substance, or as real. Does not regard these appearances, these phenomena, these manifestations as something stable or lasting, or as existent, or as enduring, substantial, material, absolute, or even authentic. That is knowing all phenomena only as momentary, mental appearances or representations. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is one of the common lotus offerings that we are doing for people who have no access to do lotuses in the future. And as you see, it's a magnificent lotus offering. There's all four or three colors of lotuses and various other temple flowers. There's oil and there's incense sticks. And this is for the family of Luke McKean from Australia, Victoria, his mother, Dot McKean, his father, Bruce McKean, his daughter, Julia McKean, and my son, Alex McKean. May they attain Nibbana quickly and swiftly and joyously by this offering to the Lord's Buddhist truth. And it's extensively beautiful inside here. The temple, because it has just been New Year, Tamil and Indian New Year, and you can see it is very much stashed up with flowers and incense sticks. This is actually the temple for the next Buddha, Maitreya Buddha, which is also was Nata Devala, which is the protector of this city of candy. Same as the Avalokiteshvara Bodhisattva in Mahayana. This is his most temple. But the temple for the Mahayana or for the Buddha Gautama will be over there. We have also offered some flowers at this temple, which is a temple dedicated to the Lord Buddha's begging bowl. And there's another one, similar one, inside the temple. There we will distribute the flowers. There you see the tree down here in the lower part is a Bodhi tree, Ficus religiosa, under which the Buddha enlightened. And this is one of the 16 saplings together with a very large Bodhi tree, which is stand over there behind, where we will go and offer water to after the offering of the flowers, as traditionally done. Then there's a lot of small temples for various disciples, and we will also offer at the small temple over there that we will go and offer the oil and oil lamps, approximately 20 oil lamps. And up there behind, there on the hills, lies Uttavattikele Forest Hermitage, which has been sacred forest around here. Candy has never been utilized for chopping wood, and actually I lived in there for 1 year in a forest monastery lying little more up on the hill on this side. Also a very, very nice place, Uttavattikele Sanctuary. When Mahinda came here to Sri Lanka, he said to the king, please remember, it is not only Sri Lanka is not only for the human beings, it's also for the animal beings. And then the kings up through the ages listened to this advice, and therefore there's a lot of protected forest here, and a whole forest department protecting these forests, not allowed to chop trees or do anything hunting. not allowed anything. It's left to the animals and those who want to live in the forest to utilize these forest monasteries. Again here, Mitteya Buddha's small shrine, Lokanatha Shrine. And now we will go over to the temple of called Dalila Maligava, the temple of the tooth, which you see lies over there. And we'll go in and offer the tooth is over there, and then we'll go out and offer the oil over there, approximately. But a very nice day, you see some Buddhist, this lady, is dressed all in white. This is a classical disciplinary thing, to be dressed all in white, full white color. And this you will see also many, there's a lady over there, full white. The classic Buddhist lay uniform. Thank you. One time, two times, three times. In the name of the Buddha, in the name of the Sangha, in the name of the Dhamma.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 97, closing in on the 100s. Recorded under the cypress tree, close to the Cypress Hermitage, in the central hill country Sri Lanka, on the 6th of April 2018. And there are three questions, as usual. But first, remember to click subscribe, click the small bell, and like if you like. Having passed all that jazz, we take the usual intro. Namo. Tasso. Bhagavato. Arahato. Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy. Honorable. And perfectly self-enlightened. Was the best Buddha. The first question goes like this. Is there any proof of Nibbana and the law of Kamma? First, I would like to say about proofs. No proofs is absolute. This one has a, when not having dealt with science oneself and not participated in scientific conferences, then one has a kind like a metaphysical religious fanatic belief in that there is, that absolute proofs exists. This is not the case. Not even in a closed circuit linguistic field as mathematics, which should be self-consistent. But by Kurt Gödel, it was proven long ago that mathematics, even mathematics, the most rigorous formulation of causality, of cause and effect, and thereby the best playing ground for absolute proofs. Kurt Gödel, he, as a young man, I think he was 26, proved that even in mathematics you cannot have absolute proofs. So anything is a relative, and that's what you have to go with. And that's why the Buddha, he said notably, and I think very clearly, you cannot hammer it out with logic. That is to say, reasoned thought, analytical thinking, going from cause A to effect B, to C, to D, to E, to F, to a whole network, trying to untangle it. This is not enough to reach the end of suffering, to reach Nibbana. So both from a scientific point of view, absolute proof does not exist. It's a metaphysical dream about a final answer to given questions. The physical sciences and all sciences are always work in progress. What was true 10 years ago and sometimes even yesterday might not be true today, after the best scientific theories and measurements. All measurements has to be interpreted. So doing experiments and measurements is and are also relative to the way you make the measurement. You can make wrong measurements and using the wrong apparatus. So there can be artifacts, we say, errors in the measurement. So no experiment is foolproof in the absolute sense either. It's a good indication. And also the Buddha didn't, when he said that logic and reason is cannot lead you to Nibbana, he didn't say ditch logic and reason. It's a good tool to reach far up on the ladder, but it won't reach you to the highest point. So one should know, I have a toolbox. This toolbox contains logic, analytical reasoning, meditation, reflection, and so on, and use each tool. Measurement, direct experience, use each tool for each situation. So I just think that this question shines out of this question that there is a belief, an inherent and maybe unseen belief in that there is absolute proofs that these things exist. This is not the case. This is not the case. So regarding the proof of Nibbana, I would say in general, no. Why no? Because Nibbana is outside space-time. It's not included in space-time. It's not included in samsara. It's not part of the world or the universe or any other universe or any multiverse. It's not part of space-time, basically. So thereby, whatever apparatus you measure, then it cannot measure, of course, something that is outside space-time. And therefore, it doesn't have any material characteristics or time characteristics or anything that can be touched or contacted by unawakened beings inside samsara. However, if you say, does this count for all beings? No. Awakened beings, they have direct experience, direct personal experience, and thereby absolute proof for this state, this experience, this reality called Nibbana. They all have it. They all have it. And that's whether they're 7 years old or they are 89 years old. They all have it. Direct personal experience. And thereby, and this I think is the only proof you really can take as a proof, it is your own experience. In while not dreaming, while not intoxicated, and with the full six senses inboard in full reasoning and functional state. Even then you cannot say, you cannot be sure, if not awakened, that it is not a warping of perception or a fermentation of thinking or as some kind of an illusion. It's very difficult, very difficult. But still it's the only chance you have, it's this direct personal experience. What you read in a book could be erroneous. What you see on television can be erroneous. What you hear from a teacher can be erroneous. What you experience yourself can also be erroneous. But at least if you are critical regarding your own perception and experiences, then you have a chance to disentangle the true absolute ones from the folly, fake and warped experiences. What about kamma? Is there any proof of... I just like to say one more thing. It is within contemporary physics, there is a lot of talk, and there has been for a number of years, and it's major research fields, about extra dimensions. And most of the front edge of physics is going into finding whether these extra dimensions are real or not. And most of them seems to be curled up upon themselves. String theory, not experimentally proven yet, and probably never will, contains 22 dimensions. And we have 4 dimensions in our current understanding of space-time. X, Y, Z, and time. But the most advanced string theory has these 22 dimensions where many collapses that fold in upon themselves and blah, blah, blah. It's a major, major, very controversial issue. Even of large extra dimensions has been mentioned, especially by the physicist at Princeton, professor at Princeton, Nima Akani. He wrote an early paper on it. So we should just know that the current physical understanding of space-time is that there are other dimensions, extra dimensions that are outside space-time, just like the Buddha say that Nibbana is outside space-time. Could Nibbana be one of these extra dimensions? I think the answer is obviously yes. But since we cannot prove experimentally yet these extra dimensions in physics, I think before we include the mind as a object that contains the mediator of the fundamentals of being, which is could be formulated as information, as bits, then mind comes naturally in, because it's mind that perceives information and categorizes this information, measures it into bits. But before we include consciousness and mind in physics, and the physicists in general, physicists are very, very little anxious to get mind on board, because they have no experience in coping with mind as a physical object, nor with consciousness. So I don't think it will happen tomorrow. But to make a short answer, yes, there is proof, direct experimental proof for each arahant, each awakened being of Nibbana. 2, there's a lot of talk of extra dimensions in contemporary physics. It's on a theoretical level. And Nibbana might be one of these extra dimensions. What about Law of Kamma? The Law of Kamma state that if you think, speak, or act with intentional content of consciousness, intention cetana is kamma, the Buddha said, then you form future probabilities. Quantum mechanics says if you make a measurement, then you are collapsing a wave function that is a summation of all these future probabilities into something certain. And this means that it seems that this universal quantum mechanical wave function, which is an accumulation of all possible, what all possible observers could see in any given future, seems to be the same as a karmic law. And there is actually, and has been for many years, considerable experimental proof about why, how minds on the other planet, side of the planet, over space, can affect physical experiments. Notably the double slit experiment, but also quantum number generators. And I'm experimenting with this myself. I'm working at collecting equipment now to be able to prove that mind can affect a quantum number generator that should not be affected by anything whatsoever, actually. And this proof was presented in 2016 during a conference in New Mexico, and it comes right here.
If you take elementary particles, quanta, photons, electrons, and so on, you send them through two slits, and you look at a screen to see what happens. If you don't know which of the two slits the particle went through, then you get an interference pattern. And this, of course, works just as well if you're sending a single photon or single electron at one time. The mystery is that as soon as you do know, by any means, which of the two slits the particle goes through, then you get a pattern that looks like it's particles. And this is, of course, the quantum measurement problem, which you can has been described before here, but I'm going to do it in a simpler form. You have some sort of a system, which could be a double slit, any kind of physical system, some sort of measuring apparatus. And the measuring apparatus does an observation of the system. From a quantum perspective, you take the tensor product between the two quantum systems, the two physical systems, and you end up with a system and the measurement apparatus no longer being independent. So we can say that the two physical systems are entangled. So from a quantum perspective, we're just dealing with complex waves. There's no particle-like behavior yet. John Bell made this sketch to illustrate the problem. Well, where does the measurement end? So if you imagine that you have a photon and it goes through two slits and it hits a screen, you might have a photodetector, and then you might have a human a counter that looks at the number of times that the photodetector goes off, and then the human eye and the human brain. All of those are physical systems. All of them are therefore quantum. Well, why do we see a particle? Why does observation make a difference? So this is sometimes called the von Neumann chain or the Heisenberg chain. Where is the cut made? When does quantum become classical? John von Neumann said that the measurement chain ends only when knowledge of the measurement is registered by what he called an extra physical factor. In other words, you can't use another physical system to end the chain because it just becomes more quantum. So you need something extra physical, by which he meant consciousness. And he wasn't alone in his opinion. Almost all of the founders of quantum mechanics said something like this in various ways, but go all the way back to Bohr and even Planck. They all said something like this, and this continues to the present day, as you know. This is today a minority opinion within physics, but nevertheless, it has a pretty prominent background. So I've been aware of this, of course, and everyone offers theories about consciousness, but nobody does anything about it when it comes to this particular problem, the measurement problem. So what we did in the laboratory is we built a double slit system, and fortunately it's a very simple type of a system. You have a laser, you have a filter, you have a double slit, and you have a camera that looks at the result. So the only new element in this experiment is that we ask people, in this case like a meditator, to keep the double slit in mind and to imagine in their mind's eye that they could see which of the two slits that the photon went through. This is, as far as we could tell, the only way of directly testing whether consciousness is actually collapsing the wave function. So this is what the apparatus looks like. The tube sticking out of the long box there is the far end of the helium neon laser, And the double slit and the camera are inside the box, so it's a sealed system. You can't see it with your eye. You can only use your mind's eye. This is the camera. It's called a line camera. And this particular one is 3,000 pixels long in a line. And what the camera sees is an alternating band of light and dark. This is the interference pattern. When you look at this in software, you can say, well, how bright is each band? And you get a picture that looks something like that. Does that show up? Yeah. So you get this sort of Gaussian-looking shape. And that's the way of looking at the interference. So if we start with that pattern in picture A, you can do a Fourier transform, which is picture B, and the peak in the middle is now the double slit spectral power. And this is the way we initially started doing these experiments, with looking at the power spectrum. And this is convenient because, again, we ask someone who, in this case, in the laboratory is 2 meters away from the sealed optical system, we ask them to keep the double slit in mind. And then the measurement is very simple. We predict that if observation is doing something to the interference pattern, that the double slit component of that interference will go away, or at least it'll go down. In addition, because this is an abstract task, the double slit itself is about, each slit is 10 microns across. And if you just simply hold up the double slit to somebody to have them look at it, they may or may not even be able to see it. So it's difficult for some people to imagine that they can, in their mind's eye, see what's going on in that space. So we do a real-time analysis of the double slit power, and we use that to adjust feedback tone. So if you have somebody doing the task, they could look at a screen, which is showing a signal, or they can simply do it by listening to the tone. And generally what we do is we have like a droning tone, and we ask the person to make the droning tone louder, make it just louder because it's a very pleasant tone, and then that if they would know that they were succeeding through that tone. This also provides a way to focus their mind on the task at hand, because mind wandering is always a big problem. The protocol is very simple as well. We compare the double slit power during mental observation versus no observation. They get a voice message which says, now concentrate, and then now relax, and this alternates. We do the observation periods for 30 seconds, and the rest periods are 30 seconds, plus or minus a random 5 seconds, for reasons I'll mention later. This is repeated in a typical session 40 times. So the whole session lasts 20 minutes. And the measure that we're interested in is a differential measure. We're asking, what is the double slit power while observing versus while resting? So that, and there are many ways of doing the statistics. We generally present it in terms of a Z score or an effect size. So we did our first experiment in this. So here's the result of the 50-session pre-planned experiment using the same analysis that we had used in the previous experiments. And this gave us a 5 sigma result. So for those of you who are not used to the term sigma, think of it in terms of Z score. It's the same thing, standard normal deviate. So we got a 5 sigma result when people were observing, and when nobody was doing the observing, we got almost exactly chance. There's the experimental results with the lag from 0 to 15 seconds, and in fact, we got a slightly better result with 2 second delay. So we decided to put the entire thing on the internet so we'd be sure that we could rigorously separate people by distance. So there's the double slip. This is sitting on a rack that has a bunch of servers on it, and we ran this for 3 solid years, calendar years 2012, 13, and 14, ended up with over 5,000 sessions done by human observers and 7,000 done by robot observers. And I'll explain what that means in a minute. So when somebody would sign onto our website, this was a public site, by the way, we got people from around the world to do this, in a non-observing condition, what you would see is this blue rectangle on the browser screen and simply saying, please relax. And you'd hear no sound. And then it would switch, you'd hear a voice saying, now please concentrate. And then you would start seeing this line move along the screen. The instructions were to make the line go up. And you would hear a kind of a whistling sound that was a tone, and the tone would go up and down as the line went up and down. And we did that so, again, you could do this experiment with your eyes closed. For what we call the robot experiment, it was a Linux system which was designed to simulate a human. Now, the beauty of this is that everything was exactly the same as far as a double slit system was concerned, because it didn't know, we think, it didn't know whether a human was looking at it or a Linux system, because they both came through the internet in the same way. So here's the interference pattern. This is the central portion of the interference pattern that the camera would see. What we did on this was a simpler measure than we did before, and this is called fringe visibility, which looks at a peak and a trough, and it measures the relative difference between the two. So the prediction is fringe visibility while you're observing would go down. And this is what we got with human observers. So some, again, approached 5 sigma differences. That was 2,089 sessions by 689 people around the world. A quantum Zeno effect, and it steers the direction that you're going. So when you take the overall results from 2013 and 14 and you reverse the sign of the results in 2014, you get a very healthy result for people and very close to chance for the robot sessions. That's a good point. Let's do the same experiment, one photon at a time. So we used a commercial system. It's a little over a meter long. And you can shoot a single photon at a time and then see whether or not you get interference with a double slit system. So we figured that if observation is getting rid of the interference, then photons should increase in this case at that point. So we set up the system to look at that point with the prediction that when people observe the system, the line would go up. We did 6 experiments, and I'm just going to mention one briefly. We call this the Illuminated Buddha experiment, because we have a little Buddha statue and put an LED in it that would get brighter the better you did. So this is the result with the Illuminated Buddha experiment. We predicted that would go up, and it went up by 2.5 sigma. So that was good. We published this last year, and this got a prize for the best paper in that journal. So we've done 17 experiments of this type, most of them, 16 of them, using a double slit system over 8 years. And you can put this into a meta-analytic software, and the bottom line is this, somewhere between around 4 to 8 sigma effects. So it looks pretty robust. So many of you may be aware that for many years, people have been using electronic random number generators, where the numbers, the basis of the randomness are quantum phenomena, either radioactive decay times or electron tunneling or other phenomena. Like the one in the upper right there is using photons that hit a mirror, a half-silvered mirror, and either go straight through or bounce off to the side, which is a random quantum random effect. So people have been using these things for almost over 50 years now. To give an example, 1985, Bob John and Brenda Dunn at Princeton University did an experiment with a random number generator where they asked people to aim high, meaning make the generator produce more ones, or aim low, more zeros, or do nothing as a baseline. And they report highly significant results. So a couple years later, Roger Nelson and I, when we were both at Princeton, decided to see, is it really true there's just one lab showing these results? Well, it turns out, over a period of about 30 years, that there wasn't just one lab. There were 68 different investigators reporting this in 152 publications, not just one experiment, but almost 600 and 200 controls. And you look at the overall results on the controls, you get something that's very close to chance in terms of the mean shift, and in terms of the experimental data, almost a 7 sigma result. So there's replications. The same kind of analysis was done again in 2006, bringing it up to date, but only looking at a subset of about half of the studies that have been done using random number generators. And again, the sigma was somewhere between 3.6 to 4 sigma results. So reductive materialism is predicated on a model that looks something like this. Physics is at the bottom, chemistry, biology, psychology, consciousness is somewhere near the top, but consciousness doesn't mean anything. And from this perspective, the idea that mind and matter directly interact with each other in some way is forbidden. Or at least it's very difficult to think of a way that it could work. Now, Stuart Hameroff has come up with an interesting model, and there are more and more models coming along that suggest there may be a way to stick within the existing scientific paradigm and solve this problem. But the other approach, of course, is to take exactly the same disciplinary structure, but just take consciousness and stick it down there. So it's a new metaphysical base on which we sit. from this perspective, just like in physics, where you have electrons that go everywhere up in the pyramid, here we'd have consciousness that starts at the bottom and goes everywhere up. So this is idealism, panpsychism, neutral monism, use whatever your favorite term is. From this perspective, the real puzzle is how do we get from consciousness or awareness into physics? Because if you solve that problem, and there are people working on that too, well then all the rest of it is perfectly fine. And we don't need to throw any textbooks away. Except we're going to throw them away every 2 or 3 years anyway, because that's what happens. They're not thrown away completely, they're just revised. So in this case, mind-matter interaction actually is quite easy to explain. So here's my conclusion, then. First of all, the role of consciousness in the physical world can be tested. It has been tested many times in many different ways. The results so far suggest that consciousness plays some sort of an active participation in reality.
Now we've gone through the proof of Nibbana, then I'd just like to say regarding this space-time and relativity, usually space-time is understood as a block that is not compressible, but actually relativity, which is an experimentally proved theory of Albert Einstein, which you see here, this talks about time dilation, time's becoming slower if you move relative to what you observe. Then the time starts to go slower in whatever you observe. And whatever you observe, if you move according relative to it, then it becomes longer and longer and longer. Shorter and shorter and shorter. So there's time dilation and length contraction. So this, of course, goes contrary to naive realism, which seems to be lying behind this question. And to punctuate this naive realism, I recommend go back to the video I made about Einsteinian relativity and Buddhism. And it's called Relativity, Relational Reality. Relational reality. That reality is a relation between the observer and what he observes. So reality is not what he observes out there, independent of him. Reality is to be understood as a relation. I repeat, a relation between the observing mind, basically consciousness, and the object out there, perceived as external. Reality as a relation. And that's the same thing as Einstein says, because he says as if the observer moves, then he affects space-time in whatever he observes. And the video can be clicked up here, and it is Dhamma on Air number 60, 37 videos ago, and it's called Relativity, Relational Reality. Relational reality. Reality seen as a relation between consciousness and the object observed. Question 289, how can one maintain a relationship with one's parents if they are abusive? There's two solutions. One, I will give what the Buddha said about how the five ways to remove an irritating annoyance. And this could be whether this annoyance is external or internal, whether it's people or things or phenomena or states or events that are passing by. Then one can use these five tricks. And this is whether, if it's people, whether it's one's parents or friends or whoever. He says about these five ways of removing irritated annoyance. Bhikkhus are these five ways of removing irritating annoyance, by which any irritation can be entirely removed by a bhikkhu right when it arises in him. What are these five ways? 1. Friendliness, metta, can be maintained towards the irritating person or situation. 2. Understanding can be undertaken towards an irritating person or state. Why are they irritating? Or why am I irritated? And why are this state or thing or phenomena annoying me? 3. Unlooking equanimity can be kept towards an irritating person or state.
unlooking equanimity, just looking on. All beings are owners of their karma, created by their karma, born of their karma, conditioned by their karma. And then, right there, equanimity springs up. One can forget and ignore the irritating person, the mental or physical state. Redirect mind to other object, pleasant object. 5. Ownership of karma of the irritating person can be reflected upon thus. This good and worthy person is owner of his actions, inherit the result of his actions, is indeed born of his actions, and only he is responsible for his actions, be they good or bad. This is how annoyance can, with the irksome can be instantly removed. These are the 5 ways of removing annoyance, and by which any irritation can be entirely removed in any wise friend exactly when it arises. Anguttara Nikaya, which you see here, Numerical Discourses, number 5, the Book of Fives, Sutta number 161. So in short, friendliness, understanding, forget, ownership of karma, unlooking equanimity, that's the way. On a more pragmatical, practical terms, I would say, if one lives with one parents and one has an option to it, then find a place to live for oneself. Because annoyance, irritation, as the same as desire and lust, it arises only with the contact with the object. As soon as you say, take contact away, then whatever state it induces, whether aversion, irritation, annoyance, or desire, lust, and greed, then this poof goes away. So no contact, no problem. No contact, no problem. This also goes if you have mental contact. If you keep thinking about one's parents, or one's boss, or one's spouse, or one's divorce 25 years ago, or what will happen 10 years from now on with this and that person and so on, projecting into the future things that has not happened yet, then this also counts as contact. It's mind contact with a given object or expectation. And as soon as this contact is cut, bloop, no problem, no irritation, also no lust, and also no feeling. So I hope this one, I can say for me, to live in solitude and thereby to cut off on a relative basis most of these contacts that I perceive as problematic with other beings, this has been a way to bliss, to happiness, to the largest possible extent I have experienced in this life. So I have lived now 16 years for no more, 17 years for in solitude up here on this mountain. Also some areas where I also lived mostly alone. And this has been the most happy period in my life. And this is because all these relations that you have to other beings and thereby their mental defilements, meeting your mental defilements, and the kind like very, very unhappy mix that in this cross points of these mental impurities, both the other beings and your own, all this is taken away. Still, you have to deal with your own, but you can say what external mental defilements, what greed, hate, and ignorance there is in other beings. You don't have to deal with that necessarily, unless it comes very close, and unless you keep thinking about it in your mind, of course. So I recommend if you live with your parents, whoever asked this question, and they are abusive, then I will recommend finding a place to live for yourself. And this goes for anyone else who are living under circumstances in the same house as a person they feel very unhappy being with. Then abrogate the contact as far as possible. Question 290. Is there a pattern of giving to bhikkhus that always result in very negative consequences for the giver? How does one maintain the desire and practicality to support the Sangha? Yes, about giving, this in general, I would say there's no giving that is that can have negative consequences. I have to qualify what that is. But in general, one should give with a happy heart. The Buddha say one should give with a happy heart to someone who is pure, worthy, or needy. And those who want in one rejoice in giving. Why is that so? Because you can say if you give something, there will always be a positive result and the other way around. If you give something material, you will always get this material back at least 10,000 times if you're giving it to more than an animal. So if you give to a bhikkhu, you will always get it back, whether pure or not. However, it might be if one gives with an unhappy heart, one doesn't like to give, one feels urged to it by somebody else or circumstances or social conventions or whatever, or one gives out of an egoistic purpose. Say, if I give this, then I may get that in return. Say, I may get more people in my shop, or more people will, through this monk, come to my hotel, and so I can get more money, and so on. It can also be that if I give to this bhikkhu, then the other people will respect me more. If I give to this bhikkhu, then I'll be more famous. Or if I give to this bhikkhu, then I'll gain more political power. Or if I give to this bhikkhu, then I'll be respected by them over there, my peers, and so on. So one is actually not giving there, it's a bargain, where one gives with one hand and then one expects with the other hand. And it's this expectation that creates the unhappiness from the result of the giving. Also, if one gives whatever with whatever unhappy, defiled mind, then this defiled mind will be coupled to the result of the giving. But the materials will still come. So the negative consequences mentioned by the asker has to be divided up in the mental consequences and the physical consequences. One person can become very rich from giving, but also very unhappy from giving in the same event of giving. There's an incident in the Tipitaka mentioned by that. And this King Pasinati, he has to go to visit the Buddha in the afternoon. And then he comes in the afternoon and the Buddha asks him, why do you come in the afternoon here today, great king? And then the king explains that he has been participating in a removal of a treasure from a very, very rich man, a seti, a billionaire, much richer than the king, from his treasuries because he had died. And so the rule goes, I think also goes for in most places of the world, that if they have no inheritance, then it goes to the government or to the state, the richness. So he has been overlooking that for 7 days they were carrying out silver, and for 7 days they were carrying out on ox wagons gold from this rich man treasuries, underground treasuries. And then doing this, the local people told him that this person had lived alone all his life. He has not participated in any social relations. He has very bad clothes on. He ride a ramshackle cart, and he eat only broken rice. And he never shared any of his riches. Never. Though he was exorbitantly rich, he never shared anything whatsoever. And so they ask the Buddha, how come that is, that he is so exorbitantly rich, but he's both unhappy, alone, without family, and he never shares anything, nor does he use his richness to induce own pleasure. As you usually see millionaires do, buy a big boat, 7 houses, have a lot of lovers and so on, eat fine food at expensive restaurants and what have you. Why was that? And then the Buddha looked back as he can and see the former lives of this particular individuality. And then he reported and told that this person 7 lives ago had also been a rich millionaire in this very same city. He was a banker for the king. He was lending money to the king. And he was on his way to the king in his horse cart, luxury golden horse cart. Then he saw a Pachika Buddha. They have 2 fingers spread long, beard, and 2 fingers spread long hair, and wear a hempen robe, very coarse hempen robe.
So they look like coarse people, but of course they're not. They are enlightened Pachikabodhi, only one step shorter than Samasambodhi, the fully perfectly self-enlightened Buddhas. And so he saw him, and then he asked him, "Ah, monk, you got any food today?" And then this Pachika Buddha answered, "No." He didn't recognize it was a Pachika Buddha. Ah, then he said, "You can go to my house, and then the food prepared for me, you can say I have ordered that they should give to you." And yes, sir, the monk said. And then the guy, he rode up to the king and performed his business. The Pachika Buddha, he went there, got his food, but partook of the food and went back into the forest, as Pachika Buddhas do, to meditate. And then on the way, then he met this person again, coming back from the king. And when this person come riding, then he saw his long, two fingers with long beard. And then he say, "I was a shameful recluse, what said bad and evil monk, because of the outer sign, he could not see his pure mind, huh? He could not see his enlightenment, his Pachika Bodhi enlightenment." So he became very dissatisfied with his giving of the food and said to himself, "I should have eaten it myself, or I should have given it to my friends, or to my family, or to my waiters, but I should definitely not have given it to this sheikh, this fake monk that is looks so untended to, that he has long beard and long hair and use a hempen robe." So he regretted that he has given, but he had already given it. He had already given it, because he have already given it, the food, to this one single meal, to this very, very pure person. He becomes a billionaire for seven lives in a row. Seven lives in a row. But in all these seven lives, the Buddha told, then he was very, very unhappy with his giving. Very, very unhappy with his richness. Very, very unhappy with his situation in general. And he never used a penny on others or himself. This, that he was very, very unhappy, was induced by his second karma. He did one karma that was good, and then he did a continuation karma that was coupled to the first karma, that withdraw the first karma partially, at least in mind, and went from happy to unhappy. However, the material thing, the food in the begging bowl, was already given and partaken of. So he could not get that back, huh? But he could ruin still his own future by this regret and remorse over having done something exceptionally good. This unfortunately is not that common. The most common thing is you see people that are very, very rich, or that are also moderately rich, but has something to give at least, but they don't give. Even though there are pure persons right in front of them, and they know them, and by all signs say they are exhibiting nobility, but they don't give. I saw this very much when I went myself pindabat inside candy in the rich quarters. I never got anything. If I go over to the poor people, then I got my bowl full in 5 minutes. So this is very, very strange, I think, and unfortunate, that most being 99.9999% of beings that can give, that could use their material richness to increase their own future state, that they spoil it, they miss it, they don't see it, basically. And that's why understanding is achieved. They don't understand that they have to give something to retain their high state in the future. They don't understand the law of karma. They think they are now I'm high. Yes, but as a monk in Thailand say, is you're high now as the apple that hangs on the tree. One day the apple become ripe, and then plunk, it falls down and rots, being eaten by worms. Then, so this is the most general case. You see people who can give but don't, who can elevate themselves but don't. So they miss the opportunity. They miss the opportunity by the tons, basically. Second thing, but this is a little more rare to see, I would say, is that those who give are not happy with it. They do something good,
but they are not happy with it because they don't understand how good it really was. They don't understand how pure the person they have given to really is. They don't see his mind, because you cannot see mind. You cannot see the purity of mind. And those who have a pure mind, they are also very humble. That's a factor of the pure mind, huh? This humbleness, this non-ego, ego gratification, running around with a big sign or flag, see me. They don't. So thereby there are no signs for the person of not so sharp intelligence and not so sharp sense faculties to recognize the good they have done, how good it really is, and thereby come to rejoice in it. As soon as they rejoice in it, then whew, they will be lifted up, both here now and also in the future. So this is the second thing, and I think this is what this person has experienced, because there's no negative consequences of giving, except if one gives with an unhappy or egoistic or defiled or wanting or swapping mind. Then one still will gain the richness from the gift, which is the karmic effect of the gift, but one will not gain the happiness that could be a karmic echo of the gift also, if one has been able to couple this gift and associate it like link between the gift and the rejoicing happy mind. If one can do that, then look back, this is basically the ideal situation, looking back at the one's death moment and say, ah, I did this and that good that is. Now I'm dying, yes, so what? But good it is that I did this and that good. I rejoice in it now. Then one will have a fortunate rebirth, because one will die basically with a smile on one's lips. With a smile on one's lips while dying. Thank you for your clever attention, advantageous consideration and kind contribution. Thank you to the food givers, the recent food givers, those who make the wheels turn around and the videos keep coming by a regular donation, and also to those who supported the meditation hall. Thank you. And may you indeed have a nice, noble, and beautiful day. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.